Good morning. Thank you for the kind invitation. I'm very glad to be here, and I will try to talk what are the now the main problems in infectious diseases in intensive care units. Okay. What are the main problems? The intensive care unit are places in which we have patients with complex medical problems, and all the patients are crowded in a relatively small area. The acute nature of critical ill patients necessitate of the use of a broad spectrum antibiotic frequently. The fever is a real problem in patients in intensive care, and must be considered when it reaches certain levels, like 38.3 centigrade, because we can have also situations in which we have lower fever and is not related to infections. And in the immunocompromised, the threshold of fever can be lower. 50% of the patients in intensive care presents with fever, with no apparent infection. So maybe in these cases the abuse of antibiotic is an issue. And fever is mainly a sign of inflammation and not just of infection. So we have to rule out causes of not infectious fever before treating with antibiotics. The infectious cases, causes in fever in ICU, sinusitis, catheter-related bloodstream infection, VAP, ventilator-associated pneumonia, catheter-associated urinary infection, and wound infection, and Clostridium difficile diarrhea. At least these are the main, I don't know if you already have this epidemic of Clostridium difficile, but in our settings is becoming a real issue. And there are also many non-infectious causes of fever in ICU. There is the post-operative fever. On the first days following major surgery is reported in 15 to 40% of the patients. Procedures, hemodialysis, bronchoscopy, blood transfusions, endocrine disorders, thyrotoxicosis, myocardial infarction, stroke, thromboembolism, drug fever. There are several antibiotics can then induce fever. Sometimes stopping the antibiotic therapy, we have a resolution of the fever. And the most frequently responsible are cephalosporins, penicillins, mainly piperacillin, and amphotericin B, and other drugs like phenytoin. Which are the sources of infection in intensive care unit? As you can see, only a lower percentage is from exogenous sources. The majority are from endogenous sources, colonization of gastrointestinal, trachea, skin, and so on. And so we have to check the patient with a nasal swab, with the rectal swab, because most of the time are they the carriers of infection in intensive care. And what are the risk factors for carriage of this multi-drug resistant bacteria? As you can see, there is hospital admissions for more than 5 days during the last 3 months. This is a risk factor for carriage of bacteria. Institutionalized mainly prison, healthcare, geriatric centers mainly. colonization of infection. Antibiotic therapy for more than 7 days in the previous month, particularly with third and fourth generation cephalosporins, fluoroquinolones, and carbapenems, end stage renal disease under chronic hemodialysis and ambulatory peritoneal dialysis, and comorbidities. like cystic fibrosis, bronchiectasis, chronic skin ulcers, which are quite frequent in long-term patients, which are the main organism, bacteria, involved. Among the gram positive, we have the Staphylococcus aureus, and in neurosurgery, at least in our setting, is the first cause of infection, Enterococcus, and then among the gram negative, Enterobacteriaceae, Pseudomonas, and Acinetobacter, which is becoming more and more frequent in all our hospitals. And as you can see, there are a few drugs that are still working, it's not easy most of the time to find the right therapy. As you can see, we don't have more families of antibiotics since the late 80s. And now we are using for Acinetobacter gram-negative patients some drugs like colistin that is very commonly used, that is as old as about 50 years or 60. It was discovered at the end of the 50s. And now is one of the main drugs used in intensive care for difficult infections. We have several treatment options, but as you can see, there are some new some drugs that are also difficult to use. For instance, daptomycin is not working at a lung level. Linezolid is a very efficient drug, but is bacteriostatic and not bactericidal. So there are some constraints in the treatment of infection in intensive care. For gram-negative bacteria, is even more difficult now, because we have Acinetobacter, Pseudomonas, that are multi-drug resistant, are resistant to all the drugs that we have. We have some strategies to overcome this problem, like for using double carbapenem, ertapenem and meropenem at the same time. Ertapenem is more sensitive to carbapenemasis, so it can distract the carbapenemasis from merem and from meropenem, and this is really working, still working. And then we have tetracycline, which is bacteriostatic, quite efficient. Unfortunately, it gives some problems, mainly at pancreatic level. So the problem is to decide, first of all, if the patients needed an antibiotic, and second one, to have the right combinations of antibiotics to use. There are also the problems of the empirical antifungal drugs. Candida is quite common, and we can use if the septic patient has been neutropenic for 5 days or more. so less than 100 granulocytes per cubic millimeter. If the patients had a long-term central venous catheter, usually gram-positive and candida are the main colonizers of catheter. If the patients have been hospitalized in ICU and received the broad spectrum antibiotics for a prolonged period. Empirical therapy for severe sepsis with no obvious focus. This is a very common situation in intensive care. So we have maybe fever, all the signs of fever, the sign of infection. We have also some markers that I will show you later on, like procalcitonin. And we have to start with empiric therapy. And so we have to put some antibiotics that have an association between antibiotics working on gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, taking into account that we are facing most of the time multi-drug resistant. So as you can see, the combinations are many and possible to use. Another problem is how long to keep on with the therapy. As you can see, usually few days are enough, and very often in the intensive care unit we have therapies that last much longer. For instance, for community acquired pneumonia, or even with ventilatory acquired pneumonia, 8 days of therapy are enough. We have other cases like pneumonia to Legionella that needs 21 days, and with lung necrosis, which fortunately is not very common, more than 28 days. For catheter-related bacteremia, a few days are enough if we are facing Staphylococcus epidermidis or Enterobacteriaceae. We need more if we are facing Staphylococcus aureus or Candida, at least a couple of weeks, and complicated infections with Staphylococcus aureus more than 28 days. And this is just a quick view, because there are also other bacteria, other species of bacteria that are coming out in our setting, like mycobacteria, other mycobacteria, or other candidates that we already never seen before. For the central nervous system infections, for meningococcemia, 5-8 days of therapy are enough. Meningitis due to Streptococcus pneumonia, 10 to 14 days. Postoperative meningitis to epidermidis or Enterobacteriaceae is a couple of weeks. Meningitis to Listeria, 21 days. Meningitis postoperative due to Staphylococcus aureus, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, 21 days, 3 weeks of therapy. I mean, we can see the good results just after a few days, maybe 1 week, but we have to keep on to 3 weeks to have good results. And in case of abscess of the brain, at least 4 weeks of therapy. For intra-abdominal infections, time for the duration of antibiotic therapy can be less than 8 days for community peritonitis and a couple of weeks for postoperative peritonitis. The practice promoting the optimization of antibacterial use in the ICU setting. We have to provide adequate initial treatment of serious infections as soon as possible. We need to know that which are the predominant disease causing pathogens causing the disease. I mean, we need to have at least an epidemiological view of what is our environment. And drainage of abscesses, empyema, other infected fluid collections, removal of infected foreigner bodies, central venous catheter, urinary catheter, and so on. Monitor of drug concentration in the serum. Avoid prolonged courses of empiric antibiotic therapy that we have seen increase the resistance of the bacteria. Consider the de-escalation of antibiotic based on the available microbiological data and clinical course. We have seen that we have for empiric therapy a combination of several antibiotics. As soon as we have the microbiological results, we have to cut down and try to use a more specific antibiotic. The use of narrow spectrum antibiotics is the main suggestion. Establish appropriate thresholds for prescribing antibiotics. I don't know, 38 of fever, the culture positive, and so on. All the places have to set their own appropriate threshold before starting the antibiotics. And develop also criteria for the discontinuation of antimicrobial therapy when the enzymes go down, when there is no fever, and so on. There are nine factors to consider when selecting an antibiotic: the spectrum of coverage, of course, pattern of resistance, evidence of track record for specified infections. This is even more important to achieve serum, tissue, or body fluid concentration. There are some antibiotics, like, as I said, for instance, daptomycin, that is inactivated at lung level, so is completely useless in lung infections, and so on. And I have the antibiotics reach the place where I want to be. Allergy, toxicity, formulation is, if possible, is always advisable to use oral antibiotic, because all the devices that break the physiological barriers are possible source of infection. And then the adherence and convenience. It's much better to use antibiotics that need less administrations. And then the cost. The cost is also important. For instance, the last generation drugs are very expensive, and maybe they can be substituted by other as efficient as those. Another issue is to treat bacterial infections and non-colonization. Many patients are colonized with potentially pathogenic bacteria but are not infected. For instance, symptomatic bacteriuria or colonization of a catheter. If we practice urinoculture from a catheterized patients, most often, very often, we can find some kind of bacteria or candida. But if we don't check for for leukocytes in the urine, we don't know if it is just a colonization of the catheter or a real infection. Colonization of tracheostomy in chronic respiratory failure is another issue. If we check for bacteria, most very often we can find some kind of a colonization, but it's not a real infection. And so chronic wound and cubital, lower extremity stasis ulcers, chronic bronchitis, and in all these situations we can find bacteria that are not an infectious, but just a colonization. And can be difficult to differentiate. The presence of white blood cells not always is indicative of infection. A failure can be due to other reasons and not to the positive culture. There are, for instance, we have the cutoff of 10 to 5 colony forming units to say that there is a urinary infection. But it doesn't prove infections, just a number to state that the culture is unlikely due to contamination. So we have to decide really to. And also, puria is not predictive on its own. The presence of symptoms and puria and bacteriuria denotes infection. So we don't have to treat if we don't have more indications from this kind of things. And the same for community-acquired pneumonia. Often it's difficult to diagnose. X-rays can be difficult to interpret. Infiltrates may be due to non-infectious causes, atelectasy, malignancy, hemorrhage, pulmonary edema, and so on. So just to have some abnormal imaging doesn't mean pneumonia. So tenets of antibiotic stewardship that is becoming more and more important because as you can see, as you have seen, there are several problems for the infectious in ICU. And we need expertise to treat them. Antibiotic stewardship can be very, very useful. What do we have to do? Limited duration of surgical prophylaxis to less than 24 hours perioperatively. Use a rapid diagnostic test if available. Solicit an expert opinion if needed and prevent the infections. Good hand hygiene and infection control practice and remove catheters as soon as possible. Let me spend a couple of words on procalcitonin that is becoming a very important marker of infections. Procalcitonin is the most extensively studied biomarker of bone disease, is the precursor of the hormone calcitonin, and its levels have been found to increase during infections at different degrees of inflammation. The primary utility is establishing bacterial infections and guiding their management, and it's open use with algorithms to guide care in association with the clinical impressions. Procalcitonin is detectable within 2-4 hours from bacterial infections and peaks in 6-24 hours, opposed to CRP, which begins to rise after 12-24 hours and peaks at 48 hours. Procalcitonin production is not impaired by neutropenia or other immunosuppressive states. Procalcitonin levels parallel the severity of the inflammation insult infections, meaning those with more severe disease have higher levels, and is a good prognostic indicator with higher serum concentrations related to the risk of mortality. As you can see the how it is, so we have the peak and then as it slows down very quickly. Situation where the PCT elevation may due to no bacterial causes, newborn, massive stress, severe trauma, surgery, cardiac shock, burns, mainly burns. In absence of infections, procalcitonin levels tend to down after incident events quite quickly. Treatments with agents with stimulates cytokines and biological drugs mainly. Malaria and some fungal infections. Prolonged severe cardiogenic shock of organ perfusion abnormalities. It doesn't raise, does not raise in case of viral infections. In healthy people, the levels of procalcitonin are very low. Systemic bacterial infections, including sepsis, the level is generally more than 0.5, with higher levels being associated with the severe disease. And in patients with suspected respiratory tract infections, we can lower this cutoff to 0.25 to predict a bacterial infection. And the cutoff level of procalcitonin to identify postoperative patients with infections may be higher than that used for other patients' group due to the cytokine release during surgery. The effects of using procalcitonin to guide antibiotic therapy and the studies that use procalcitonin algorithm, physician can consider other clinical information and override algorithm based on their judgment. And the procalcitonin guidance reduced for sure the antibiotic usage. Maybe it didn't reduce mortality or morbidity, but for sure the antibiotic usage. Using procalcitonin guidance to discontinue antibiotic therapy not increase, and as indicated by length of stay in the ICU, and procalcitonin guidance to discontinue antibiotic therapy did not increase mortality. In conclusion, despite the efforts, infections in ICU are common. Infections are challenging for the kind of patients and the break of physiological barriers. Antibiotics are often incorrectly prescribed. Inadequate therapy or incorrect dosage for a particular infection. Administration of antibiotics for non-bacterial infections and excessive long treatment courses are frequent. And the wise use of antibiotics and infection control strategies can reduce the burden of ICA. And successful implementation of evidence-based practice coupled with innovation of novel approaches and technologies tailored specifically to the complex and dynamic environment of the ICU are the keys to raising the standard for infection prevention and patients' safety in emergency care unit. Thank you.